We have encountered phosphorus in a variety of organic functional groups and transformations throughout the semester. And in the last webcast, we talked about the structure of nucleic acids with their phosphodiester. We want to go beyond structure in this series of webcasts and actually pull together just about everything that we've encountered with phosphorus chemistry into one section, and this is the section on bioorganic phosphorus chemistry, where, unlike the last webcast, where our focus was on structure, in this webcast our focus is going to be on reactivity, and so the making, for example, of new bonds around phosphorus, such as in the case of the formation of a strand of RNA, where that phosphodiester backbone is synthesized. 1I6H is the PDB code of RNA polymerase. That's the enzyme here that reads the DNA template and uses that information as, again, it corkscrews down that DNA template, spitting out the new RNA strand with the complementary base pairing that we talked about last time. It's the making of this phosphodiester backbone that involves the reactivity that we're interested in this webcast. To get started talking about and bringing together all of the bioorganic phosphorus chemistry, let's briefly look at the structure of phosphoric acid. Phosphorus is in its oxidation state 5. Phosphoric acid has 3 protons to lose. They're lost at a pKa, which has a delta pKa of about 5 units for each proton, leading to the structure of this phosphate trianion. The physiological form, the most common form, is the one that is the dianion, just above physiological pH, or right around physiological pH. In fact, what makes physiological pH buffered is this orthophosphate group. The trianion has a resonance delocalized structure. I'll let you look at these on your own, but you can see that each of the oxygen atoms can carry that negative charge. There's really no such thing as a phosphorus oxygen double bond. All the bonds are equivalent. We would draw the hybrid in this way with partial negative charge, not full negative charge, on all 4 of the oxygen atoms. So it's a fully resonance stabilized trianion. Well, the successive increase in pKa has to do with the buildup of negative charge resisting further the loss of the proton, because that will cause that negative charge to build up. That's the basic idea behind phosphorus, the most important of the phosphorus building blocks. And you can see, and what's most important about phosphorus is that the functional groups are going to have phosphorus tetrahedral geometry centered around 4 oxygen atoms. What we want to do next is begin to look at variations of this, and we're going to change the hydrogen atom with an organic constituent. If we only put 1 constituent on there, that'll be a phosphomonoester. If we put 2 substituents on, we'll be talking about a phosphodiester, as in the case of, say, RNA and DNA. A phosphotriester would have 3 of those hydrogens replaced with organic constituents. Let's look at phosphomonoesters next. We've encountered this already. For example, when we talked about the Shikimate pathway, phosphoenolpyruvate showed up there. And phosphoenolpyruvate has the attachment of this enol type group as an enol ether, but or as an enol ester to phosphate, to that phosphate group. So it's a phosphomonoester where that constituent is an enol. We recently just encountered glucose-1-phosphate, which was a good leaving group for glucose, making the glycosidic bond. That bond is the bond that undergoes bond breaking. And I don't really want you to pay too much attention to this, but these are going to certainly be generally found as their monoanion, or very often as their dianion form. That first proton is lost even more. It's a more powerful acid than is phosphoric acid. What I really want you to pay attention to is what comes next, and that is the chemistry that takes place at phosphorus and around phosphorus. At phosphorus, hydrolysis can take place, and if it takes place non-enzymatically, so just in solution, the process is thought to occur in a very SN2-like process, so that what's drawn in the brackets is actually a transition state. a transition state where bonds are being made and broken. This is not an intermediate. It's in the act of bond forming and bond breaking. And the key thing to note and the key thing to highlight is the availability of this proton, which can serve as an intramolecular general acid to assist the breaking of that phosphorus oxygen bond. And so as the nucleophile, in this case hydroxide, approaches phosphorus, this bond begins to weaken as it picks up the proton. And you can see partial bond breaking between that oxygen and that proton, and bond making between that oxygen and the proton, so that the leaving group is lost as the neutral alcohol and the dianion is created. Notice charge neutrality is maintained, negative charge, and the dianion on the product side. So that's the way that hydrolysis takes place. And you're going to notice that this SN2-like process for the phosphomonoester is much different than the chemistry that takes place at phosphodiesters. Phosphomonoesters, SN2, phosphodiesters, they'll take place by a different mechanism. Chemistry can also take place around phosphorus, not just at phosphorus. So at phosphorus is this hydrolysis reaction. Around phosphorus, very much like we saw what takes place in the case of glucose 1-phosphate, there's going to be a displacement of that phosphorus-oxygen bond where this serves as a leaving group. It actually is a leaving group whose leaving group ability is comparable to a bromide. For example, in an SN2 reaction, we can break that carbon-oxygen bond and emitting that phosphate group as a leaving group. So SN2 chemistry can take place around phosphorus with that phosphate group as a leaving group.